President Ferdinand Marcos Jr. orders the Information and Communications Technology Department to boost its security against cyber attacks. This after several government agencies suffered from data leaks. The Science and Technology Department confirms it was among the agencies that encountered a breach in August. Despite the immediate resolution, DOST Secretary Renato Solidum Jr. says there's a need to fortify the agency's cybersecurity defenses.
Every agency should be wary of its security. So it's a standard for all agencies to really make sure that their ICT systems are really safe.
Meanwhile, the ICT department admits they are aware of the breach but can only act on select cases due to limited manpower.
Meron kaming pinaprocess na more than 3,000 events already, no, from January to now. Unfortunately, we're less than 30 people. So ang ginagawa niyan, namimili talaga kami ng cases and issues.
We need the system, and hopefully that system would be provided to us to address all these. It's unfortunate na kailangan mangyari na yung kaliwat ka ng mga pag-atake to make us realize how important that we set up a system to prevent these kinds of attacks from happening.
Defense Chief Gilbert Chodoro also calling on authorities to boost cybersecurity through adequate funding and personnel training. A group of cybersecurity experts floats the possibility the hackers behind the recent cyber attacks in government agencies are not based in the country. The Information Security Officers Group suspects Manila is being targeted by a bigger country but refused to name it. The group now urging the government to boost its cybersecurity to ensure protection of the country's critical data.
There is a possibility that we're actually really, as a country, being targeted now, considering that we're trying to stand on our own 2 feet and stand up against a bigger country. One of the things that we're really concerned about is making sure that they actually cover the three things. First, people. Second is process. And third, technology. And the sad part is seemingly lack of concern for the implementation of the technology. Mm-hmm. It's as simple as implementing an antivirus program. Mm-hmm.
A bit of good news for motorists. A fourth straight oil price rollback expected next week. Estimates show a liter of diesel may be cheaper by at least 90 centavos, while kerosene prices may go down by at least 80 centavos. But for gasoline, prices are expected to increase by as much as 70 centavos. The transport group behind Monday's scheduled strike now mulling if it will push through. This after Malacañang asked them not to pursue the strike. Jose Carretero joins us with more details. Jose, good afternoon. What do you have for us?
Good afternoon, Rica. Transport group Manibela will decide tomorrow if it will still push through with a scheduled transport strike on Monday, October 16. Manibela Chairman Mar Balbuena said officials from Malacañang have reached out to them last night asking not to pursue the strike. Balbuena declined to name the officials from Malacañang, but he said the officials have requested for a dialogue with them tomorrow. Despite this, he said the group is 100% prepared and will still go with the strike once the dialogue did not turn out favorable to the sector. Expected to join the strike, according to the group, are jeepney drivers plying the 600 routes in Metro Manila. The group is asking not to push through with the jeepney phase out. Balbuena said their provisional authority will end on December 31, and they have been warned by transport officials that it will not be extended. Originally, the supposed phase out was set March this year, according to Balbuena, but was moved to December 31 after some transport group hold nationwide transport strike. The jeepney phase out is part of the public utility vehicle modernization program by the government. Meanwhile, some transport groups have decided not to join the strike should it still push through on Monday. Liga ng Transportasyon at Operators of Pilipinas, or LTAP Nationwide President Orlando Marquez, said he already talked to his members nationwide and they have committed not to join the strike. The reason, according to Marquez, is some transport groups can still talk with the government and lobby their problems, such as the jeepney modernization. Transport group Piston also said their members nationwide will not join the strike. Piston President Modi Florande said, though they are against the jeepney modernization program, they are still conducting a thorough studies on their actions that will be initiated should the government still push through or proceed with the modernization program. Rita.
Thank you so much, Jose Carretero, reporting live. The Subic-Clark-Tarlac Expressway set to hike its toll fees starting October 17. Motorists traveling between Mabalacat City to Tarlac City will have to pay an additional 25 pesos to use the highway, while those that will travel between Mabalacat and Tipo, Hermosa, Bataan will be charged an extra 40 pesos. As for motorists that will use the full stretch of the highway from Tipo, Hermosa, Bataan to Tarlac City, the additional toll fee may reach up to 196 pesos. The new rates are meant to allow NLEX Corporation, which owns SETEX, to operate and maintain the highway. President Marcos removes from a list of next year's Philippine national holidays the anniversary of a 1986 uprising that ousted his father, the late President Marcos Sr. The Presidential Palace says February 25th, 2024 cannot be considered a regular or special non-working holiday since the date falls on a Sunday. The palace explains observing the event as a holiday would have minimal socio-economic impact since it coincides with a rest day. But Malacañang declared the December 8th Feast of the Immaculate Conception of Mary a special non-working holiday. The day also falls on a Sunday next year. The Presidential Communications Office points out that December 8th is a holiday by law, while the EDSA anniversary is a holiday by virtue of an executive order. 73 employees of the Philippine Immigration Bureau have been dismissed or suspended on charges of corruption. Justice Secretary Jesus Crispin Remulla and Immigration Commissioner Norman Tansingco say they are committed to cleanse the Bureau of rogue employees. 72 corruption cases are pending before the Immigration Bureau's Board of Discipline. 100 other cases were initiated by the Justice Department. Both agencies are investigating the alleged practice of immigration officers who escort travelers with defective documents in exchange for a fee. Despite the large turnout in candidates in the Philippine Village and Youth Council polls, there are still several areas where no one is running for certain positions. Victoria Tula tells us how these vacant posts can be filled up in this report.
Unlike most villages in the country where there are several candidates for Sangguniang Kabataan chairperson and members, the St. Ignatius Village in Quezon City does not have any. This is why some residents, like Eloisa, can't help but worry as the October 30 Village and Youth Council polls draw closer.
It's best to have a representative so that the youth has a say in issues as well, and that because the youth always has something new to bring to the table naman.
According to the Commission on Elections, 8 villages in the country do not have candidates for village chief. 124 have no candidates for SK chair, while in 543 villages, no one is running for SK member. COMELEC Chairman George Garcia says the same predicament happened in 2018.
Ko rin po maintindihan kung bakit walang nag-file ng certificates of candidates. Siguro nga dahil naiiksian sila sa termino ng mga mananalong barangay and SK officials.
Winners in the October 30 polls will only serve until December 2025, which is shorter than the mandated 3-year term as the result of a Supreme Court decision. The Department of Interior and Local Government assures that there is a way to fill up vacant posts. Under the Sangguniang Kabataan Reform Act of 2015, special elections may be held in places where no one is running for SK. If the SK chairman position is the sole opening, a succession will be observed. This means the SK member with the most number of votes will be appointed chair. If that person is unable to serve, the member with the second highest number of votes will become chair. A katipunan ng Kabataan Assembly will be called to recommend someone to fill up the vacancy that will be left among SK members. That person must meet qualifications and be approved by DILG. Succession will also be followed for vacancies concerning the village chief based on the local government code. The highest ranking Sangguniang Barangay member will be appointed.
Dahil dito magkakaroon ka ng vacancy sa mga Sangguniang Barangay. No? So the seventh seat shall be filled doon sa appointment ng city or municipal mayor upon the recommendation of the Sangguniang Barangay.
The DILG also needs to approve the said appointment. If there are no candidates for village chief and Sangguniang Barangay members, a special elections may be held.
ang susi kasi rito, huwag mahinto ang function ng barangay. Dapat diretso ang delivery ng basic services.
There are also villages where candidates are running unopposed. An example of this are the more than 7,000 villages where candidates for village chief do not have rivals.
Siguro na-settle na at wala na yung clan wars and therefore nagkaisa na lang sila na iisa na lang ang patatakbo. Siguro kontento sila doon sa pamamahala ng incumbent.
Unopposed candidates only need one vote to win. Victoria Tulad, ABS-CBN News.